We are the Felus Cremins band. Allison, daughter of Terry and Sharon, she of the long fingers as a baby. And this is Brian Cremins, my partner in music and life and song and all
this is my first show ever in Indiana.
Brian's from Connecticut, so it's like learning. I would say to him, like, Brian, when did you even learn that Indiana was a place?
I learned from it. I learned about it from John Mellencamp. Because that's what we knew in on the East Coast. So we might have to do a Mellencamp song later.
So yeah, just to give you a feel tonight, we're going to do a couple of our original songs, got a chunk in the middle of some covers, some show tunes, some rock songs, some songs we're going to send out to those who are near and dear to us, and finish it out with some of our own originals.
But they're kind of geographic, right? So the next song, it is a Connecticut song. Should I tell a little bit of the story?
Well, we like to joke that, like, at these shows, we should pass out, like, car bingo, you know, like when you're a little kid and you, like, fill in the map, you know, and you're like, oh, yeah, we've been through Iowa now. And so this is kind of what we do, like, at these shows.
I think that happened in Los Angeles. I bought somebody a beer because they kept track of all the places we sang about during the show.
They did. So, yeah, we're going to take you to Connecticut.
So, where I'm from, there's a music shop on the Naugatuck River called Banquet Music that's been there since 1952. And I bought my first nice guitar there. I got a Rickenbacker 330 there in 1994 or something. My first nice guitar. I've been playing for a while. And so we went down to Banquet. An old man, Banquet, still is there. He passed away several years ago now. I bought the guitar. My dad and I were leaving the shop, and he said, well, good luck with it. You hope you have fun. He said, many years ago, there was a young girl who took lessons here, and she was a wonderful drummer. And upstairs, she would take her drum lessons. But later on, she got to be known more as a singer. I can't remember her name. She's very popular. And he kept talking, and then I realized, oh, he's talking about Karen Carpenter, because the Carpenters were from New Haven, Connecticut. They grew up on Hall Street, and then when she was, I think, middle school, I can't remember, maybe almost in high school, they moved to Los Angeles. And became famous, but according to old man Banco, she took drum lessons on the second floor of Banco's in Ansonia, Connecticut, on East Main Street. That's probably what this song is about. My mother shows up in the middle because her favorite TV show in the 1950s was The Lone Ranger, and she liked it because she realized The Lone Ranger didn't have to go to school on Mondays, on Monday mornings, and she did, so that's why she wished she could be The Lone Ranger.
Thank you.
and when we first started playing music together, almost 10 years ago now.
Oh, is this Olivia?
This is Olivia.
You tell the story.
So I love this story. So Brian is a college professor. He teaches a two-year school north of Chicago. But for a long time, for a number of years when he first moved to Chicago, he taught high school. And he lived on the north side of the city and taught on the south side. So he would drive down Lakeshore Drive to get to the school. And one day, about this time of year, maybe a little bit earlier in the spring, there was like, it was like the old Burma Shave, you know, things where there was like a series of signs. And it said, will you go to the prom with me? And then the last sign was this kid in a tux, Olivia, you know? And so Brian was like, oh my God, who is Olivia? What is this story?
Did they go to the prom?
Did they go to the prom?
I hope so. Was she even driving on Lakeshore Drive early enough in the morning to see this happen?
There's a lot of unanswered questions, which is what makes it so perfect. So it originates in Chicago and Needle, Connecticut. This one's
I just, because I couldn't, I didn't know the route numbers when I first moved out here, so I just picked a highway in Connecticut. So.
Ryan sings on this one.
Thank you. So my cousin on my mom's side, the Lithuanian side of the family, toured a lot in the 70s as a roadie. So he worked for Hart, he worked for Kansas, but he wasn't always on the road. He had his own band, and he worked at a theater in Connecticut called the Webster. And a couple of summers ago, but this is recent, right, Allison? That he told
that
us
we were
the story?
Out there.
Yeah, so my cousin comes over, and you know.
On his motorbike?
On his Harley Davidson, yeah. He starts showing us all these pictures of when he was working as a roadie, and he's an electrician by trade, and so did a lot of electrical stuff on the road. But when he was home in Connecticut working at the Webster, he was called Mr. Hospitality because his job was to make food for the bands that would come through. So he's like, yeah, you know, in the late 70s, early 80s, I made food for Billy Joel, I made food for, you know, the Grateful Dead, and he's like, I also made chili.
I made chili for the Clash.
Yeah, for Joe Strummer of the Clash.
For the punk people in our audience.
And I was like, what is it like to make chili for Joe Strummer of the Clash? So
this is our imagination.
This is kind of what we, yeah.
What we imagined. Jimmy had his imagination.
Yeah. And we have the accordion now.
Am I locked on the bottom or?
No, you're, yeah.
I'm open?
I think, I don't know. I've never played an accordion. I think it's.
All right.
Do you need to introduce the accordion?
This is the accordion. No, this wasn't my dad's primary accordion. Happy to carry on the tradition. Nowhere near his skill level, but happy to.
Our cat really likes the accordion.
She gets a little hypnotized by it.
She's excited about it. first time you've ever played accordion on stage.
Yes. Oh, thank you for that. what's next? Oh, another New England song.
Yeah.
Going out to our good friend, Tris Carpenter, who very graciously sort of hosted us. We did this show in Los Angeles at the very beginning of the year, like literally from January 4th or something.
Yeah.
And it was a great time, and did a bunch of LA songs out there, you know, like all more Zevon songs about drugs and stuff, because that's what you do in California. So hopefully a little more wholesome here.
Yeah. We took out all the more Zevon songs.
We can't do them without Tris. But today's Tris's wedding anniversary, so we songs about him, and we dedicate it to our good buddy.
And he lived in New Britain, and so the song is called The King of New Britain.
Geographic themes of this around, but, you know, are not around us for whatever reason. And so just even that list of names that I read off in the middle there was a tribute to a lot of, like, minor East Coast bands that Brian knew when he was playing, you know, up and down the tri-state area, in Connecticut and New York and Boston area.
Some of whom are still around, some of whom are not, but yeah, so we
very specific,
very specific to that mid-90s scene. So
sending love to the memories of some of those bygone bands.
But this song,
we're moving into Indiana.
Do you want to tell them about the person that this is based on?
Well, the song is called Bloomington Gal, and it's not about a Bloomington Gal, it's about a man who is in love with the Bloomington Gal. A man named John Lee, who likes to wear gold lame and thinks he does a killer cover of David Bowie's Heroes.
Yes. He's a person that our friend Peter, who's a drummer, says is a man with a lot of rock star problems, but without the rock star bank account, I think is the quote. Yeah. So
I sent it out to John.
Bloomington gal, where have you been? We're a long way from home, with no sunshine in today. I'd like to see you anyway. And I must admit, I didn't mean to say, but the sound of your voice and the Indiana rains got me thinking. Doesn't matter anyway. And all I can see, too far ahead of me, and it doesn't seem to matter much. Bloomington gal,
things
never learn. As the sun is coming up, the wheels start to turn outside. It's just another morning. Guess I'll never learn. As the sun is coming up, the wheels start to turn outside. It's just another moment.
System while they were sound checking, so they would keep playing and like rocking, you know, like acting like this is going really well. And Gary would slowly turn the faders down,
or
and shut it all.
Like
or,
as he got drunker towards the end of the night, it just would like he would just drench everything in reverb. So like whatever was happening, it just sounded like you were at the bottom of the well.
Yeah, I think I was doing one show one time where he did. He's like, now we're gonna go into Jim Morrison Doors territory, and it would echo everywhere. So.
And Gary unfortunately passed away. He was ill, and we didn't know it, and found out through friends of friends in the music scene in Chicago. Chicago. And so Brandon and I have been playing music together since, you know, late 2009.
Yeah,
so almost 10 years now. And when we were recording our first album with our first band, you know, it was just, it was real DIY. Like, our guitar player at the time was, you know, kind of, he's a good sound recordist. So we'd set up all the mics and everything, and in just like a brick, you know, enclosure somewhere, a room that we found, recorded it. And so we recorded the song, it was fine. And he took all the files home and he was mixing it, and he got real spooked out because, like, the sound just cut off right at the end of Gary's song.
Yeah, and he said, I can't fix it. And
he's like, it's gone. And we were like, that's Gary.
But Kevin never listened to the lyrics. He was like, what is this song about? I said, it's about Gary. He's like, oh, that's what happened.
So,
right.
The spirit of Gary had one last fade on our recording. The songs were here.
Hopefully nothing will explode while we're playing this. I want to hear the sound of a two-drink minimum in your 10-cent town. But I'm dreaming of the lake shore and the pitch of the waves, illumination of our better days. So when I'm leaving, you'll be the first to know. With the daughters of the frontier, I'll be dancing slow. Get this 12 string because the accordion was too loud. Like, and we were playing at home, and I'm like, I can't get over the accordion. I didn't know that they were that loud.
Yeah, when we
I should have done that.
Yeah, it was pretty amazing that I was, you know, we live in Chicago, and I was taking the train to work one day, and my chiropractor called me on the phone, and I was like, I don't know if my chiropractor's calling me, so I let him voice. I listened to the message, and he said, you know, he's a friend of my dad's, and he said, and a musician, he's a great drummer, and he said, Allison, the secretary at the church, we were doing a clean out of the church, and she found an accordion that belonged to your dad, and said, if you want it, come get it, and wow. If you don't, we'll donate it, you know, to someone who will use it. So I called him back and I said, yes, I want it, coming right away. So that weekend, yeah, we drove down to Highland, where my dad's church was, and this beautiful piece was waiting there. It's in perfect condition, and like I said, it wasn't my dad's primary accordion. It was one that I think had been given to him at some point that he had for backup and used for sort of church functions and playing for the kids to dance and stuff. But really, really, really super glad to have it. And so yeah, the first time that we pulled it out of the case, you know, and again, I didn't grow up playing accordion the way that my dad did. I didn't have had lessons or anything. I played keyboard, piano. And so I just like laid on the bellows and just strung it out, and Brian's just jaw dropped. He was like, I've never been that close to an accordion. I mean, I had no idea how loud it was.
I grew up playing in punk rock bands, like loud, loud bands, you know, and I was like, wow, that's a loud instrument. You know?
So, our neighbors love us.
Yes.
So I guess I'm learning. They've been pleased, I'm sure. So we're not gonna play accordion on this one. This is when we go into our cover zone. So we're gonna start playing a few songs that might be more familiar. And yeah, again, like everything we do is in tribute to sort of people that we love and influences on us. And so one of the major, major influences of my life, obviously, was my dad, Terry Felus, the great Terry Felus, the great musician. And the summer of the year that I was born, he conducted a pit for Jesus Christ Superstar. And, you know, always just for his whole life talked about it as just one of his crowning musical achievements. He was so proud of the show and the music that they made. So I grew up listening to Superstar and have never had a chance to do it. And now I'm gonna do one of the songs, so.
In these paths.
both. I had these.
So as Brian was saying, you know, his primary knowledge of Indiana was John Mellencamp for a long period of time, and you sort of like, it's very cute. Brian's a professor. He's an English professor. He wrote a book. There's a book on sale that, you know, we have out front that is just came out in paperback finally, and so Brian is deep into knowing stuff and learning stuff, and so. When we started dating, you know, and it was like, to me, I'm like, Connecticut, like, where even is Connecticut? What happens out there? And he had the same thing for me with Indiana. He was like, well, there's just fields? Like, what is it that we do here? And so his solution was to listen to the music of Indiana, and foremost poet-scholar of Indiana would be John Mellencamp.
Because the first two 45s I got as a kid were Abracadabra by Steve Miller Band, and Hurt So Good by John Cougar at that time. He was not yet John Mellencamp or John Cougar
that
Mellencamp.
Okay.
And those are my two favorite singles. So we're going to do Steve Miller because he's whatever. Well, he went to the University of Chicago.
He could have done Abracadabra for dying.
He could have done Abracadabra, yeah, which is a great song. So I said, let me delve into Mellencamp, and it's great.
And so I, you know, he would come home from school, you know, he leaves really early in the morning, and I'd see him when I'd get home from work, and he'd be like, man, John Mellencamp is just the best. He would just be really feeling it, so.
One of my best friends in Louisiana, like, he said, what took you so long? Because he's from Jackson, Mississippi. He's like, I loved Mellencamp growing up. My buddy Brandon, so he's like, he went through the discography with me and said, here's the records to get. So I'd be excited to know we're doing this.
From Scarecrow?
From Scarecrow. Second track on Scarecrow. It's great, great lyric. I mean, great album. One of his best albums in the 80s. So here we go. Greyhound 30 miles beyond Jamestown. He saw the sunlight in the Tennessee line. He looked at the young man who was sitting beside him. He said, I'm old and kind of worn out inside. Thank you. list of other Indiana songwriters, didn't you? To decide what's...
Try, but, you know, again, it was like the nexus of Indiana greats, and also stuff that we had.
No, we enjoyed, right.
The one thing I'm bummed, sorry I didn't bring any coal for it. Next
we both had coals. We were going to learn one, but then I had to finish the semester. So next time.
But this one is, we spoke about the steel mills of Gary, and this is a song by one of the famous Gary families.
With the introduction by...
Introduction by...
A Wisconsin writer.
Hamlin Garlin.
I don't know if there's any Hamlin Garlin fans in the house.
Going
way back into the late 19th century, but he was a really great Midwestern, great writer, sort of like the Mark Twain school of like local color, but not as funny and a lot sadder, but good, you know, really, really good stuff.
Bringing the, as again, Brian, deep into the research into being Midwestern, so this is one of the things that he found for me that I thought was very lovely that I wanted to read for you before we get into the song. Local color in a novel means that it has such a quality of texture and background that it could not have been written in any other place or by anyone else than a native. It means a statement of life as indigenous as the plant growth. It means that the picturesque shall not be seen by the author, that every tree and bird and mountain shall be dear, companionable, and necessary, not picturesque. The tourist cannot write the local novel. From this it follows that local color must not be put in for the sake of local color. It must go in, it will go in, because the writer naturally carries it with him, half unconsciously, or conscious only of its significance, its interest to him. He must not stop to think whether it will interest the reader or not. He must be loyal to himself and put it in because he loves it. If he is an artist, he will make his reader feel it through his own emotion.
Beautiful.
We wanted to send this out to my dad's brother, too, who unfortunately couldn't be with us tonight. He is the biggest Dan Fogelberg song I've ever known in my life. He loves Dan Fogelberg. It's like his thing. Loves him. He learned Fogelberg, too, and he had to do emergency babysitting tonight for his grandkids.
We had to ask my dad, too, like, what Fogelberg songs he
was doing.
And he went with the, you know, he said, well, of course, leader of the band, which you listened to, and you were like, no.
I was like, ah, you don't want to do it. It's cheesy.
And then For the Roses, which is about the horse.
Well, and then there's that
Old
Lang Syne.
Old Lang
Syne.
That's a creepy one, like, a little bit, because he's, like, in the grocery store, and
sees the old girlfriend.
Yeah, and he's, like, bugging her, and he's, all she wants to do is
buy some orange juice, probably.
Yeah, and then go, yeah. So we said no to that one.
But we found the intersection here of Dan Fogelberg and Midwestern songs.
Yeah.
So in Illinois.
From his, I think it's his second record.
They've been a lot of drugs.
Produced by Joe Walsh.
So.
James Gang, well, and Eagles, so yeah. It's a great, great song.
Good song. Last of our chunk of covers, And yeah, I kind of don't know what to say about it. I sort of, in the bathroom and in the weeks leading up to this, I was thinking about all these profound things I'd say. But, you know, it might not need it. Just a song that I think a lot of people here will be happy to hear. And I do it in a very loving spirit.
Thank you.
and, you know, don't feel the need to take them if you don't want them. Just one free.
They're free.
Pardon?
We think people can be
they're free.
They're free.
So take them if you're interested. But it's, yeah, it's it was a project that we did with a good friend of ours where he had done this, like, abstract graphic novel that had, like, no words and no characters in it. And someone asked him to do a reading of it. And he was like, how do I do a reading of a thing that doesn't have any words or any pictures that are real? It's just squiggles. So we wrote a soundtrack to it, and then that became this performance thing that we do. And so that's a little segment of a project called Codex. So we've only got a few more songs for you. We're going to finish up here. Two more. And this next one is just basically a song about me moving to Chicago and being bright-eyed and enthusiastic, and I'm in my early 20s, and I'm like, life is grand, and I was going to, like, look at an apartment, and my car broke down on Lakeshore Drive, and I was like, oh my god, it was like 4:45 on a Friday, so traffic was about to be really bad, and it was a whole shebang, and I got towed off into the beach, and then, like, I had to find another tow truck to come get me to the garage, and the tow guy came and got me. It was amazing. Took me to a place called Marvin's, that's still in Chicago. If you're ever broken down in Chicago, take a car to Marvin's, because they're doing great work. And so the next day when I went to pick up my car, and I was so grateful because they gave me a really good deal. They clearly hadn't cheated me or anything. And the guy was like, oh, one last thing. And I thought it was like the last piece of paperwork to sign or something. And this is in 2002, you know, so burn CDs were still like the thing. There wasn't like iPods yet. And he pulls out this burned CD with the logo of Marvin's Garage on it, which had the Lamborghini, you know, like sticker. And he hands it to me, and his English was not the best. And he just hands it to me, and he goes, American romantic music. And I was like, this is the best thing I've ever gotten in my life. And I put it in the car, it was like Crimson Clover, like a bunch of Legions tunes. It, like, this mix, it was like this mix CD.
But Credence too.
And Credence too.
It's the Don't Stop the Rain.
Don't Stop the Rain, yeah. So it's just an awesome CD. Like, I've replicated it online. You can go listen to it online now, because it's so great. But so this song we call American. I space of love that all energy creates that I would not totally be the person that I am without them, and just with all of their just time and energy and love and dedication that they put into just every person. You know, whether you were in stagehand or on the center stage, or whether you come and sit in the audience, like, you feel the love, and that's the theater space that they've built. It's not the room. The room helps, and it's nice to have a good room, but the love is the container. So it's been so meaningful to be planning for this and texting Angie and saying, like, this is what we need, and what do you have, and when are you going to be there? And it just planning it has just been a delight, and playing here has been a delight. And so we thank them for having us here and bringing us all together in so many ways, and now and in the past and in years to come. So love to them and thanks to them. And we'll close you out with a song called, which one are we going to do?
Gingy.
We're going to leave you with jazz. I'll just sit by you so I can hear the guitar. Thank you.
number one, the CDs are in the middle room here, and a copy of Brian's book is out there, which you can see him about.
That's
but I think
that's
Chris's
that's
book, but she will allow you to look at it, maybe not touch it. But we could not.
No flash photography.
We couldn't be with Allison and Brian together when it was Allison's true birthday, but we're calling this the true birthday.
Well,
it's, what is it, Angie?
This is, well, I used to say she hit 40 because,
oh my goodness.
You know, we're only 40. It was February 18th, 1979, right before we did Superstar, and she did her, I don't know how to love her, it just killed me. But, so today's her 40th. And three months out of 12 is 140. So 40th and 140th birthday. And we have a little, just a little.
Yes.
Danny?
Danny, are you here?
Hey, Danny. And she almost killed me when she played a song. She didn't have to name it. Did anybody else recognize it but me? Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
It just took me away.
Now, do me a big
night,
for
Brother Knight's sake.
Angie, I'm passing the name on to her.
Say
I'm
again.
Not the hoe in the show anymore.
Say again.
I'm not the hoe in the show anymore.
Oh, that's right.
She did Jesus Christ Superstar. She gets it now.
and her dad played the Hammond organ. We still have that. And the lesson and everything conducted and played. And that was a beginning also of a lot of kids who played music more and then went on to study music and teach music and continue Terry's music. The song she did was called Anthem, and it's from Chess. And we have a little Anthem borrowing. Okay, so, when he turns around, you'll see it.
Yeah.
Her kids were involved with us, and oh my goodness. And we really can't thank Allison and Brian enough. I mean, we've been talking about this for a long time. When they came to see Randy Nugent in one of his shows here last August.
About a year ago.
Did any of you come for those?
Yeah.
Randy
Nugent,
he did his Pete Seeger and his Woody Guthrie. He's in Colorado now doing that show, but also reading one of his new plays based on, he did The Life of Hank Williams on the Road. What's it called? Whatever the play musical is, he played it. And then he just wrote a new play called Hank's Wife, Opry Etta. So he's reading that and discussing that tonight in Littleton, Colorado. And Riley sat here, and when she sang Anthem, it reminded me of it, Riley. We knew Riley when he was 6 years old, sixth grade. And he sat right here one night in 2012 and watched Brandy and made some life decisions that night, too. You really did. So it was wonderful. But we can't thank you enough, Allison. Allison, we want you guys here from the good old days to know Donnie, especially, where's my Donnie?
Right here.
Right there. Right there. He's behind Nancy. So
we have a list at home of, like, the own five drummers. Like, we can't work with drummers anymore, but you're one of the five. One of the five drummers that we
have. It is on a list.
It's literally, I created a list that we have.
And you heard from Ed Bylon before you came here, I believe.
We saw him.
Yeah. They played in Los Angeles at another theater that one of our other graduates handles, Paul Storiel, with whom Allison did shows in high school. And I, by the way, I did a bad thing. I had her in the wrong graduating class. My old memories of what it used to be. It was not class of 96, it's class of 97. Because otherwise she'd be 41 and a quarter. but we got to see her the second or third day from the hospital. And her brother Paul and her sister Stephanie are being an awful lot to us as well. We've lost Terry, but I know Terry was smiling down and maybe actually crying down. And at the end of it, I know he went, yeah, that's what he does. Okay, Terry Felus did his student teaching with us. So some of you never heard of it. You don't know who you missed. But if you've ever heard of it, Linda has, and a lot of the others have, you know what a wonderful musician he was.
Oh, yeah.
I tell you, God bless the child. Let's go room. Okay. And my dad was born in Sony, Connecticut.
Oh,
my
no.
Father, youngest of 15 Italians.
Ah.
No shit.
Oh, yeah.
And Sony, Connecticut. So
yeah.
I got Connecticut roots.
Oh, yeah.
I just about peed my pants.
Oh, yeah.
No kidding. I have relatives in New Haven.
Oh, yeah.
And of course, and some
Harry too.
Oh,
okay. Come and get your cake.
Hey, oh, actually, what happened? It's little. Have your choice of chocolate ones or vanilla ones or pumpkin ones. Little round.
Great.
2 bites. So 2 bites is not going to be
good. Thank you all for
and that. I just wanted to let everybody know the 50-50 winners just gave us the money.
Oh.
Nice.
Never heard anybody say dying to me.